Hello and welcome.
Hello.
Time for yet another lecture, the second to last in this course. We have one more lecture next week.
Yeah, and then we have one more part that's gonna be more reading resources and watching pre-recorded demo videos.
And a couple of peer instructions. We have one peer instruction tomorrow.
Yeah, we're gonna be in Webbsjö tomorrow.
Yep. Hopefully.
So be there. We have the, you could ask questions about the assignment and stuff also. So we will be in Växjö from 10. We start.
Yeah.
Past over 10. We start.
Yeah. 15 minutes past 10. But we will probably be in the classroom from like 9:30. Depending on
the buses and stuff.
Yeah. So if you have any questions, you could be there ahead of the peer instruction.
Yeah.
And one lecture next week. So you should all be have started with the second assignment.
I hope now. So.
Yeah. Basically, you have all the puzzle, all the pieces of the puzzle for the second assignment already.
We have something
to add today.
And we're going to talk about it today.
Yeah. But if you haven't started with the second assignment, please start because it's there is quite a few things to do in that assignment, I think. So,
but today.
Yeah, today we are on the topic of web security.
Yeah.
So the topic of today is web security, and web security is, it's a topic that you could have one or two or three courses in.
Yeah, it's a very big topic, and just not only web security, the security of servers and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But we're gonna try to fit it in one lecture and talk about the most common stuff that you need to know when programming web applications.
Yeah, and server web applications in particular.
Of course.
I know some of the students taking this course or our program students have had a prior course in security, I think.
Yeah, I think so. Like so that. It could so be some stuff you already know about. But
And we have resources as well as usual to this lecture, I think, if you look at the course webpage.
Yeah, you have a couple of articles or documents. We have linked it on the page, and I think there is a recorded demo of HTTPS. How to add it into your application.
Yeah, and this lecture will actually extend over to the peer instruction tomorrow, because we have some topics that we will not cover today that we will have on the peer instruction. So it's really important that you are on the peer instruction because that part is not recorded.
No.
So be there or attend online.
As we did last time.
Yeah. So content of today. So we are going to talk an introduction to web security and where to find information about web security. We're going to look at the most common attack vectors when it comes to web security, the most common entries into your application security-wise, and how to kind of make sure that those attacks isn't executed on your applications, because that's the important thing here. We will talk about authentication and authorization as well, and user management, and this is what you meant with the...
Exactly, that will be a part of the assignment. You have to implement handling the users, how to log in, how to register and stuff like that, and we're going to talk about it in that topic.
And the last piece, the HTTPS, I don't think we have the time for that today, so we will see how.
But if we don't get it today, tomorrow on the peer instruction, we do
HTTPS a requirement for the second assignment, or is it the third?
I don't remember. I think it's on the third assignment. You should put that application on our production server, so you're going to use HTTPS.
Yeah. So, okay. going into the field of web security, if we, I mean, we have done this trip backwards in time so many times, but if we go back to the beginning of the web wasn't meant to be this advanced application platform that it is today.
No, the web was invented for just sharing information with hyperlinks and stuff like that.
Static resources.
Yeah, exactly. And in a closed community, in the research communities and stuff like that. Mm. So security wasn't one thing you were thinking about because, well, it's going to be in this closed community and we trust everyone.
Yeah.
So it was a happy time.
Happy time, yeah. So you didn't need to think about those things. But moving onwards, of course, we know what happened. All those techniques evolved. Applications started to run on the web as a platform.
Yeah, we're using the web to so many things in our lives today. Mm. We have shopping, banking, communication, everything. And we before we had applications running in the desktop with a security model for that. Mm. And when people are trying to get this application running on the web, we have a whole different security model. And since the web and the HTTP doesn't have anything with security built in, there will be some problems. And we're putting a lot of complex applications with data that is very important that will be secured. Mm. So
and that has led up to, I mean, today on the new or every day on the news you more or less get those information about new attacks being carried out, passwords being on the loose, and so I think the public has also starting to catch up with that. Oh, this is actually important, because 10 years ago, most people you asked on the street, they said, "Oh, my password and email, that's not so important. I don't have anything on the web." But today, everything is there. And going forward, we also have Web of Things, for instance, and Internet of Things.
Of course, we're talking about the web applications being more part of the society. We have open data stuff, and we have data about citizens and stuff like that. Are handled by web applications, so it's very important to keep it safe or so no one can modify it or getting information they shouldn't and stuff like that. You talk about Web of Things, where we using web technologies about the Internet of Things stuff to control devices and stuff like that. And when you start using the web model, you get a different security model that you have to handle. Mm. And that's why we have this lecture.
Yeah, and that is actually I mean, we have a lot of companies coming into this area right now, setting up cameras and stuff, and there has been multiple leaks of like cameras having unsecure APIs, so that attackers could easily
get access. And the handling of passwords, using the default passwords and stuff like that,
A big thing is as well is this says downtime with distribute denial of service attacks carried out on a daily basis.
Yeah, and we're not gonna talk about that too much in this course, because it's on a different layer. I think not the application. So maybe you have.
It's really hard to.
You will have to have detection system before the application and stuff like that. But since we're putting our application and our information on servers connected to the internet or to the web, that will be a problem. Mm. And you see, the worst thing that happened. one bad thing that happened when they did a DDoS attack on GitHub.
Yeah,
and we couldn't work for a whole day.
So we were just sitting around looking at the unicorn, I think.
Yeah, exactly.
They have some kind of pink unicorn as a.
And that shows how important this is, because we.
Yeah, we rely so much on web services. So and denial of service. I mean, the thing with denial of service, if we didn't say it, like just trying to overload servers so they cannot act upon requests, for instance. And I mean, you could get this problem in applications as well. If you write bad code, if you write we have talked about the queue in Node. If you block the queue and you get quite a lot of requests to the application, you might block your own application. So denial of service attacks could be carried out in the big and the small as well.
Yeah, exactly.
But we will focus. I mean, in this lecture and in the course, we will focus on securing the server application and thereby securing the client application as well. We will not look at firewalls and WAFs and whatever.
Yeah, and that's a good point because we are, as we said, we are rendering code on the clients. So we as server applications developers are responsible for not putting our clients into... security threats.
And as you written the last point there as well, that I mean we get new attack vectors all the time. Because we're rendering code on the client, we are using a lot of more APIs both on the client and on the server. So the technologies that the tools that we have will always introduce new security problems as well. So
I think we have it on the next slide now, where we talk about
risk factors. So when you are going out working in this field, one risk is not for you because you will know what to do. But out there are a lot of developers just not aware of security at all.
No. The thing is, as I said, the writing web applications could be very easy to do, and you do it at home, and you sit, and you don't the tutorials. You follow the tutorial that doesn't care about security.
Yeah, or tutorial since 2002 or whatever.
Yeah, exactly. So there is a lot of bad code running in production. Available from the web, I think, because the security matters haven't been taken so hard in every cases when coming to web application development.
Yeah, so maybe jumping ahead of time, but SQL injections or SQL injections is a really common attack vector, and it's been around since 98.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's almost 20 years, and each and every year there are new leaks with passwords and hashed or non-hashed passwords leaking from applications just because there is SQL injection attacks possible, or that you have opened your application for SQL injections. So that's really, really strange. Why is that? And that's probably because the developers are trying to build applications without the proper knowledge.
Yeah, exactly. And that may be a part of the third and
that the cost could be a problem as well.
When you sell your application, you mostly sell the functionality, and the customer looks, oh, it looks great, oh, you can do this and that. But the security, maybe not so important when selling stuff. We have time to develop what the customer wants, and we don't focus on the web security, which we always should, of course.
Yeah, and depending on the application, of course. I mean, if you're writing an application for the e-health government, you will probably have quite strict rules for things like this. But on just writing, I mean, I will just write a simple application. I will have a couple of thousand users. It's not important.
It will be very bad for the company having the web application if someone can hack it and order stuff for free or delete all the data or stuff like that.
And as I said, new attacks and new technologies coming all the time, so you need to be aware of what you're doing.
And as we say, staying up to date, it's an important thing to read blogs, to read articles where they have found new attacks, and so to know about them. So that's an important thing.
Yeah. So when moving into this field, when writing applications for the server, there is one important thing, and that thing is to always be suspicious, because you need to be suspicious of all input into your application. Often you think that, okay, so if a user uploads a file, that's an input. I will be really cautious about that. Or if a user is filling in a form with data, I will be really suspicious about that data. Yeah. And then you might be using an API, for instance, or getting data from another server, and you just don't care. You just put it right in your application. Yeah.
Because I trust that company. But that company can have some security holes, so someone has hacked into their system and could pollute our system that way.
Yeah. So like this quote, the application must always assume that all input is potentially malicious.
Yeah. So, and that's the main point for all we're going to talk about today.
So we are going to focus on some security issues or attack vectors, as they're called. And we have focused our attention to the OWASP community or organization that is every year releasing a new list of known security problems in web applications, and they have a list, the OWASP top 10 list. You have the URL on the slide. This organization this list is in, I think it's released 2013, and they release a new list every third year. But this year it's on hold, so will be released in 2017, I think.
So then we'll come with a new document.
List. Yeah, yeah. And they have identified 10 security or attack vectors that is really, really important as a web developer to focus on, and we will focus on some of those.
And they describe how they work, how to protect yourself against it, and stuff like that. So it's a really good resource to go to when talking about web application security.
We will not talk about all of them, but we will focus on those in bold font. The first one being injections. We're going to that, but injections in general is like inserting malicious code into the application.
Yeah.
That's a big problem because
in one way or another, get your code executed on the web server.
Yeah. The second one being broken authentication and session management.
Yeah.
We will look at authentication and session
management. Yeah, we will look how to do it on the Node and Express platform. Yeah. It may be different in different platforms, but the main theory is good to have.
Yeah. And I think in this one we also include things like secure passwords and
exactly.
Things like that. We will have a look at that. Cross-site scripting is a attack that is a classic attack, injecting client scripts and running those client scripts in your application, that an attacker gets those scripts in and run them in your application, and you can get a lot of the interesting information by doing that and make things happen, and we will have a look at that in detail. The insecure direct object references, that has to do with
putting files. You have you maybe have a config file or stuff, but you haven't secure, so the users can guess the URL and get the configuration file as a JSON or whatever. Making bad mistakes about that.
And when working with Express, we are explicitly telling our application where static files are located, and it's only those files that the server will release, and then we are having routes that really specify our application code, but so it shouldn't be a big problem.
No, but you should think about not putting stuff in the static folder and stuff like that.
Don't put your configuration files in the static folder.
But that can happen.
If you have another website, I mean, we are talking Node in the Node platform in this course. But I mean, if you're in an Apache environment, you need to think about this.
And I've seen you can use a file-based database, SQLite, and I've seen applications that puts the SQLite in the static, and you can get it through guessing the URL, and you will download
the database. And then you can do whatever. Security misconfigurations. I mean, it's hard to configure a Linux server to be.
That
cover all your bases.
Yeah. And you have to think about the Node modules. That could be known security issues with some of the models you're using. So that can go. That's also the ninth point.
Using components with known vulnerabilities. Or using components, I would say. I mean, known vulnerabilities could be unknown as well.
So
there were no vulnerabilities when you included this module, but later on.
Yeah, and the security misconfiguration, it could also be the firewall and stuff outside the application, so we're not going to...
We will not focus on that in this course at all. Sensitive data exposure, so this is more like an information security aspect that... What information about the users are this application?
You have a lot of information or data, and some of it is more stuff you don't want to show because of integrity or stuff like that. But then you do an API to it, and the API you don't think about it, and through the API you can get some data you shouldn't have. That could be one.
Yeah. Missing function level access control. What's that one?
Authorization. More.
You
shouldn't get resources. If you are logging in, you should only see your own. Or delete or your own resources.
Yeah, so the classical thing is that you have like a user ID in the query and you just change the user ID.
And then you get access
to another user's.
You can put lots of other things below these points, but
authorization is one big thing there. Okay, cross-site request forgeries, CSERF attacks—they are happening more and more frequently. I think, at least, even though the awareness of this attack is growing, and many frameworks has built in support for preventing those kinds of attacks, but we will discuss them as well. We discussed components and the 10th unvalidated requests, redirects and forwards. I guess it has to do with how routes are being handled.
It could be things like that.
So, but I mean, this is 3 years old.
Yeah, so what do we think will happen to the new release of this?
Yeah, that would be quite good to predict, but it's hard. As I said, we discussed this yesterday, and you said that the 8.1 will probably drop, and I think it will get higher.
Did I say that?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, cross-site request forwarders. Okay, so... Because frameworks have a lot of support for stopping those kinds of attacks might drop, but since the awareness of this attack is growing, it might lead to more attacks on the CSERF level and will increase. So I'm really not sure, and maybe this attack is getting more. More air under its wings because of how we use the web today, and we'll discuss that later on. I'm not sure. One would hope that injection attacks wouldn't be on the list, even. But
You may think so. But okay, we get new technologies, new ways to inject code into. Okay, we have no SQL, so we are free from SQL injections. No, we aren't. So.
Yeah. So probably, I would be surprised if injections is not on the number one still.
Okay.
So this is on record, so we can check back when it's released in the spring.
I think it's so big, so it will.
Yeah. I think there might be some things missing, like, I mean, the big thing since the 3DS has gone past is the cloud being more, I mean, spoken about, and so maybe that will introduce something with server configuration. I'm not sure, virtualization, maybe there is something there. I'm not sure.
Or if you put it under A5.
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe that will go up.
Yeah. And I'm not sure why social engineering is not one of the points in this. Yeah. Because social engineering is always happening. Yeah. And it's the simplest of attacks. And it's the hardest one to maybe...
Yeah, but it maybe not have the web application security to do. It's on they maybe think it's on
another level. But I mean... It happens.
Yeah,
it happens
of course.
All the time. Yeah. And just last week in Sweden, we had this we have the bank ID application that 6 million Swedes of 10 is or 9 are using for authentication against banks, all the government services.
Yeah.
And they showed a vulnerability that basically meant that calling a user, telling the user that, hey, I'm from the bank, should we discuss your stock portfolio or something like that? And then the person in the phone asks the person to verify him or herself using the ID. And what is happening is that the attacker is just logging in on that user's bank. And really simple attack to do if you have a phone. So
you fool people with getting the password and stuff like that in that way. So it's
Let's see if it shows up on this list. I'm not sure.
We were discussing the A9, the components. Since we are using Node, we know we're using modules. Have you checked all your modules that will be downloaded and inside your application when doing a NPM install or installing a module that have dependency on other modules?
I mean, just have a look in the Node modules folder after installing Express. It's a lot of modules, and those modules have submodules. And going through all of those modules, it's a lot of work, but probably a lot of work that you should invest some time in before going to production, because we have a lot of
examples. And we have tools for it that could check all your modules against known vulnerabilities, and you should do. And I think the NPM people are working very hard on this.
Yeah, there is a lot of discussions. This. Problem with I don't remember the package
it was a well used little package,
the one that concatenated the end of strings or sanitized the end of strings that just were removed from NPM. I think we discussed this earlier, that was removed, a lot of applications broke. It's hard to stop a thing like that from happening, but that I think has grown the awareness of the problem with modules in the community.
Because the NPM and Node is a young technology, it's pretty unmature, and now when these kind of things happen, they have fixed it and it will be taken under consideration.
Yeah, going back to the question we got in Slack regarding this bank ID problem. It was described in the media as a security vulnerability in the application, but
reacted on that.
as a matter of fact, I think it's more or less a social engineering attack, and it's really really hard for the application to stop that from happening on the application level. They released a new version of the application, which basically, if two sessions are trying to log in with the same at the same time, you will get a message in the application. But I mean, you could fool the person that you call saying that you don't need to log in. I will log in or just use your credentials to verify you. So it's really, really hard to stop that from happening. And I mean, it's always like this. Simplicity comes with a cost, and the cost of security. So BankID is a really, really simple and good solution that, I mean, it's gotten so much implementations because it's so easy, so everybody can use it. Even people not used to technology can use it just with a smartphone. And so that's the good thing. The negative thing is that you could use social engineering to get around this kind of problem, and it's only education that could stop that, I think.
It could be confusing for a person that doesn't work within IT when it describes, and
it was a lot of confusion in the IT sphere as well when this was released, just because BankID was releasing a new version fixing the problem. So everyone was, what? Is it really a problem with the app? But that was just last week. And that's a problem as well with media. I mean, we had I will talk more about that tomorrow, but we had this password theft application show that the Swedish media reported on a couple of weeks ago. That was also quite inaccurate, scaring a lot of people. Good thing they were scared, but maybe they were scared because of the wrong reasons. But I will talk more about that tomorrow.
Yeah, we have to
move on. Yeah. We will move on to more in-depth code attacks or attacks against our application, and cross-site scripting, XSS, is one of those attacks. It's called XSS because I guess the C was
taken before.
So XSS for cross-site scripting. So the problem with this or the case is this: the an attacker is trying to get his or her code into your application and executing the code inside of your application, typically client-side code.
Okay.
So think of it like this. You have like a forum, or you have a field where the users could comment on a post or something like that. Mm-hmm. If I, as an attacker, is able to write script into this input box, and those scripts will be shown in the comment sections, all users will execute those scripts in their session.
Yeah, because we trust the server.
Yeah.
So we visit the URL and we get
comments from the servers. The comments should be all right, but they are actually executing client-side code in the background, stealing your cookies or whatever, sending those to another server. One thing is, as I said, stealing the cookies, because if you could steal the session ID, you could log in the user or the attacker as that user during the session. And now we talked about last time how to use secure cookies, for instance, to
and that's why we call session hijacking.
The problem here is that the application is not sanitizing or validating the input from the user.
We are trusting the input without checking it. That's the problem.
And it's not only, I mean, the typical case is, as I said, it's a form on a page. But that often has quite a good validation and sanitation support, because most of us developers know that this is an attack vector. But I mean, you have other sources of input as well. You could for instance, add it to the URL. If you have a query in the URL sent to the server, if you can inject code into the query, it might be executed on the server as well. So I mean, we should not only focus on forms. We should focus on all inputs.
Yeah, exactly.
And as we said, the input could even come from an API we are using.
So beware.
I mean, say that you are, for instance, just to take another example, say that you are showing posts from a forum. You're selecting different posts within a category from another forum via their API, and you are retelling those categories or something like that, showing those posts.
Some kind of feed or something.
Yeah, in the forum, maybe you are supposed to write a lot of code. It might be a coding forum. So you are writing code on the forum, and this code is sanitized when outputted and shown and da da da. But in your application, you didn't think of that use case. So so you are sucking in those forum posts, and you are presenting them on your page without sanitizing the output. Then you you could write malicious code in the forum, making it run on your application. So 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 you always need to be aware of validation and sanitation, and we will get back to that. Yeah, keylogging. You written keylogging. I mean, that's one thing. If you get code to run on the client, you could potentially
add a script just checking what key you and sending it along to another server.
Yeah, yeah. And phishing doing this. You could present false URLs, and you could do so much.
Think about it. What you can do with client JavaScript.
So this is a problem. So let's have a look at how this attack is done in more detail. So the first thing is, okay, so we have the browser, the victim's browser. We have our web application, well, our website, and we have the attacker's browser, or the attacker in this sense. So the first thing...
Yeah, and the attacker also have a server.
Yeah, so it has a browser and a server. So the first thing is that the attacker is, for instance, posting to a URL in your applications that are supposed to take in posts. Yeah. Like if we do it in Node, we have this route set up for acknowledging posts. The problem with this site is that so scripts, for instance, might be sanitized or validated on the client. Might be
okay.
So you have a form, but you are validating so the user don't write scripts.
So we get away with the problem.
So we could think that gets away with the problem. But I mean, the attacker could set up Postman or whatever. Sending.
And you have done web scraping, you're simulating being a browser.
Yeah. So the user can send whatever to our applications, whatever. We cannot hinder the user to send anything. It could send whatever. So the problem is that we receive this, we add it to the database just in plain text, and then the victim is visiting this page.
So this thing, the one post, is in our database now.
And the user is visiting the page, and the website will take the posts from the database, present them in HTML format, and send it over to the user's browser without sanitizing it at all.
Okay.
Then we will have a script like this running inside of the client's browser. Mm-hmm. This is the simplest form. Mm-hmm. What will happen when the script is run is that the window location will be set to the attacker's web server, and it will send the document.cookie information to the attacker. You can do this in much more subtle ways that the user will not see this at all. And now the attacker has the cookie information with a session ID, and the attacker can then go on and identify itself against the web server, because we have this stateless, as we talked about before, stateless protocol. So what is the problem in this case? So the problem, as I described it, is that we trusted the client to do the validation. Mm. You should never do that. You should always...
You should have client validations, but that's not enough.
No, the client validation, that is more for user experience.
Telling the user, okay, you didn't fill this correctly, or just giving information for the user.
Yeah. But, I mean, in case of, for instance, the programming forum, I mean, then we would like the user to be able to write code.
Mm-hmm.
In a forum, for instance.
Yeah.
So then we can't validate script tags, because the user might be want to show an example of how to use script tags.
Mm.
So then we have another use case. So I think we could skip ahead to this one. We could discuss this by validating and sanitizing. Validating is when validating the input.
Yeah.
And sanitizing is
making sure it's washed, or what we call it, before putting it into the database, sanitize more the output stuff from the database.
Yeah, and there's a discussion going on. Should you sanitize or should you validate? Should you do both? And I mean, that depends. You should probably always sanitize when you do an output.
I think so, yeah. That's the main part, yeah. I think.
And you should probably always have some kind of validation of the data coming into your application. But in some cases...
It's hard to know the use cases for the data. So do you know it and you take that design decision,
it's a good thing to do. Yeah. But in some cases, you just want to... I mean, we have this data. I don't want to touch it. I just want to put it in a database. Maybe later on we will have use for HTML tags in
And one problem with just checking the input, in one point you probably get data from another source putting in the database, and you
checked one of the inputs
You forget, if you have the output you always
And sanitizing is in the other end. When you write when you have the output, you then make sure, okay, so if we have tags, for instance, elements in this text, we will replace them with the HTML entities like greater than, less than, and encode the harmful characters in a way. When talking about validation and sanitation, we often talk about whitelisting and blacklisting as well. Yeah. And this is two methods of doing the validation sanitation. Whitelisting being telling what characters are okay.
Accepted. Yeah.
So we can say that, okay, we accept this, A to Z, and some other characters, for instance. This is probably the most secure thing.
I would use whitelist before blacklist. That's the opposite, that you tell the stuff we don't want. Yeah. Because you're going to have a problem. You forget something and then you always have the blacklist.
Yeah.
It's better that updating the whitelist than the blacklist, because if the blacklist doesn't fit, you have a problem.
Yeah. But on the other hand, you have problems with whitelisting as well. Because, I mean, if you haven't handled names, for instance, if you're handling names from all over the world, we have quite a rich set of characters that should be into the whitelist filter. We cannot just have A to Z, because we will miss out on Swedish names miss out on other names. So it's quite hard to write good whitelist filters as well.
Yeah.
But I mean, if you have, for instance, if you have a if you're looking at a specific query we are not doing that node, but when I wrote PHP application, it was quite common that you had some kind of query saying action equals delete. Insert. Put the verbs inside of the query.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, in that case, you should probably whitelist only those verbs and exactly those verbs, because if you need to add a verb, you need to add it to the whitelist as well.
Okay.
And then making it safe. So it all depends on the use case. And I mean, when it comes to your application in the second assignment, you are probably using a template inside of Express, I hope.
You should check out how the template engine works.
Yeah.
Because
you will find out that it probably has some kind of support.
Or you have to configure it, I don't know. So check how does your template engine work when outputting the stuff from the database and sending it to the client.
Yeah. And we also, I mean, if it's hard to start sit down and start writing, I mean, if you start writing regular expressions, for instance, you would probably end up in a mess. So a good thing could be like looking at modules for doing this kind of whitelisting, blacklisting filters. Mm. There are a lot of them out there. You could, for instance, use these XSS filters from Yahoo if you like. But
check that up.
But be sure to if you're using a module like this, read up on it. Make sure that it's up to date, that it's not old, that it's used. And
in many cases, what we're going to talk about today and combining it to the assignment, you will find it could be very easy to do in Express, but we're gonna talk about it in the oral examination, so so we know that you have understand how things work and how to check and so 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 do a read up on on not just taking a module and whoa, it's so easy.
So that's cross-site scripting, getting scripts into your application and executing them. So and I mean often this is cross-site scripting is the symptom of an injection in many cases that you get injected in.
And it's often a part of combining with other attack.
Yeah.
Because it's a way to get that attacks more harmful.
Yeah. Okay, so moving when you talk about cross-site scripting, you're often also getting into the CSERF attacks and the CSRF, but it's pronounced
cross-site
CSERF.
Request forgery.
Yes. Yeah. And in this case, I mean, in the last slide, the user trusted the application. The user trusted our web application as being a secure application, but some attacker got script into our application, and the trust that users has in our applications, the attacker can take advantage of them. In the CSERF attack, the user trust the browser instead of the application, and that will also be harmful, as we will see. So this is called forged requests, what it is basically when you, when you're logged in to an application, you get a session.
Okay. Probably a cookie.
So you probably have a cookie with a session saying that you are logged in.
Yeah.
So in a secure application, if you get an XSS script into that application, the script cannot read this cookie because you have a secure cookie.
As we talked about in the last lecture. Yeah.
So we cannot get this session.
No.
But instead, what we could do is fool the user to visit one of our sites.
Mm.
That could be doing an XSS attack on another popular site. So when the users are visiting that site, we have scripts running on that site, or even getting the user to visit our suspicious site. I mean, if you're trying to download something to a game, Minecraft, for instance, you will end up on quite some not that good sites. And getting to one of those sites, you could run the risk of a CSERF attack, because what will happen is that when visiting this site, the bad site, that bad site will make requests against the site that you are logged into.
Mm-hmm.
So say that we have a forum that you're logged into, this site could actually post requests to that forum.
Okay.
So the site knows that there is a popular forum, Facebook, mm-hmm. for instance, and this is the URL for posting new messages. And when a user visits that site, we post messages to Facebook, and they will end up on the wall of your Facebook account because you are logged into Facebook at the same time as you are visiting this site.
Mm-hmm.
And the browser is, in this use case, the browser, I mean, the browser sees a request going out from the browser to Facebook, and in that request, it will include a session cookies. So when the request hits Facebook, for instance, it will see that, oh, this is from this user. Okay, so I will post it because this user is authentic.
Yeah, it looked like a real request because it's coming from the browser and it's have the session cookie.
Yeah. And hand on heart. Do you say that in English? I'm not sure. Handen på hjärtat.
I don't
Swedish.
Know. Hand on heart.
I mean,
to be honest.
Do you always log out when you have visited a site?
Yeah.
You always log out from GitHub. You always log out from Facebook.
No,
Twitter,
of course.
Da.
You should maybe, but you don't.
You don't.
Yeah.
So you have
it's
an active session.
The simplicity of always being in logged. I don't have to, but they have. No.
Of course, Facebook, for instance, have a well-built support.
Yeah.
You can't do this attack on Facebook, but you can do this on many, many other sites.
No.
And
you should know it when you are writing your application.
Yep.
That's the big point.
Yep. So just to see this with a picture. this one, the attacker, you can tell because he's
yeah,
evil.
He's very, very evil, as you can see.
And up here you have your money.
Yeah, so it's some kind of important.
So you could probably not do this on serious banks.
No,
as well, I mean,
this example of the bank application. When you read up on the CSERF, you often hear this bank application illustrate the danger of it. But of
more
course,
likely, it's a smaller application.
Yeah,
not handling.
And as I said, the thing is that you know about it, so you don't mess up your applications when writing them.
Yeah. So in this case, the attacker is getting some kind of form into using XSS probably into a site that the user visits, or in some way lures the user to go your application.
So in the first step we have done a log in get the session and not have done the logout. So
we are logged authenticated in. Yeah. against this bank.
And we visit the
bad site. The next thing that happens is that when visiting this site, the client is posting data to this application, telling us to do a withdrawal to this account or whatever. And because of the bank will see this as a valid session because the user is logged in, and that is the information.
Like being just, yeah. So the attacker has some way known the post URL and know how to send that question.
Yeah. So how do we stop this from happening? Well, there is a simple solution to this called synchronized token pattern. And that is not just trusting the information sent from the browser in this case the cookie, we are adding something else, more or less like a two-factor authentication in this case, that we are telling, it's not enough with a session cookie, we need another token as well. And how you do this is that, okay, so we have a form, for instance, that will do an action.
Yeah, that we expect a post coming from this form.
Yeah. Yeah. And then when we render the form for the user, we're adding a hidden input. Calling it underscore CSERF or whatever. And we have a value of this generated token.
Yeah.
We need to remember this token in the session in some way.
Yeah.
Because when the user posts this form back to the server, we are combining this token with a session to validate the user.
Yeah. So we know, okay, this was posted. That obviously came from this, or someone that has the ability to, because you can do an AJAX call, then you have to get the CSERF token also with that AJAX call, but you have the, you are the client in both cases.
And the attacker cannot get this token.
No.
Because, I mean, if the attacker gets a form from the same bank, and gets a token, that token will not be associated with the session.
No, it will not be the same.
No. And then the attacker, you could think that the attacker could upload a script on the site or on the site and then getting sending a GET request to the bank and getting the form back. Mm-hmm. And it will. I mean, the attacker can do that. It could send a GET request using AJAX, for instance, and getting the form. But inside of the browser, we have this security mechanism telling that, okay, so this site cannot read information from this site.
Mm-hmm.
So it will not be able to read the token. The browser will do the GET and get result back, but the attacking script cannot read this result. So this is a built-in mechanism in all browsers.
Mm-hmm.
So there is no way for the attacker to get a hold of this token. And this is basically how it works. Will you write this, so if you were to do an Express application, for instance, would you start generating tokens and handling the sessions?
If you want to go that way, you could, of course. But if you check around and do some research, you will see that others already have produced middlewares for that. So know about the CSERF. Research how to protect your Express application against it, and you will see that it's pretty easy in most cases. Yep. But you have to know the how it works and why you're doing it.
Yeah, and that will be one part of the assignment as well. So CISA, I mean, in this case, we are focusing on getting money and and things like that.
Yeah.
And that is not the only way that CISA attacks are being used. There are many other different cases that might not be on top of mind. Like, say, for instance, that we have Amazon, the big bookstore or the big store that sells a lot of products.
Okay,
it's real, and you sell knives.
Yeah,
you have the best knife. No, you don't have the best knives, but you have knives that you want to sell to get a profit.
And I want.
You want those knives to be seen, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what we will do is in Sweden, Amazon is not that big. But I guess in the US, for instance, a lot of Americans are logged into Amazon when surfing the web.
Mm-hmm.
So what we will do is when a user visits our site or a site that we have injected a script on, we will send requests from that user's browser to our product page.
Yeah. Okay.
So
just
for
get request.
Yeah. Yeah. Just get a request. And for Amazon, it would look like that you are visiting. You're really interested in those knives.
Yeah.
So the next time you visit Amazon, oh, look at those knives that you have looked at 500 times.
Yeah.
Those come on top all the time, and you will probably. Or maybe if you do this on a lot of people and they are going to buy knives for Christmas, they might click this and you will get a profit off it. So it's not just stealing
the system.
Things. Yeah, we're trying to.
Yeah, and you can think about voting system, more simply voting system very well.
Yeah,
in
you,
some
you,
way
you
I
want
get...
to win a prize in a photo contest or
exactly.
whatever. You could take
so
advantage of this.
So you can use this kind in more. Other, not just bank applications or as you think about, so in more subtiles.
Yeah. It's more subtile.
Do you say subtile?
Subtile.
Smaller manners.
So be aware of this attack because, I mean, as soon as you are trusting that, trusting the browser only using the session, you are always in the risk being attacked like this. And you should always think about that attack when using sessions.
Yeah, and as said, the important things your server application should not be able to do CISURFs against.
Yeah. So I think we should segue into injection attacks.
Yeah.
But maybe we should have a short break. I vote for 5 minutes.
Yeah, I think we have a lot more to talk about.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, probably. So see you in 5 minutes. Please, if you have questions, ask them in Slack and Live Coding TV or Live EDU. Questions will be answered after the break. So we made it.
Yeah, just in time.
Got coffee and have a run. We are, as I said, segueing over to injection attacks. And
question on our Slack channel.
Okay, so take that one.
Was HTTPS a requirement on assignment 2? I don't think so, but read the requirements on that assignment. It's definitely required on 3 and assignment 3.
Yeah, and we could say, I mean, you are handling credentials in the second
you
assignment.
Should,
yeah, but for that...
It's not that hard. Just watch the demo. And you've seen a lot of guides that declares an object into the session with values that, probably should be secure. You can do a lot of things when creating the session cookie. Maybe you just should have a user ID or stuff, but the session cookie will be hashed or encrypted or what we can say in many ways. So you probably won't need to think about that.
No. Okay. Yeah. So going on to injections. So in many cases in XSS attacks and season of attacks, and common problem was being able to inject code into to the application in some way because of not validated or sanitized output.
Yeah.
Validated input or sanitized output. A more common injection attack is the SQL injection attacks that are so common. And as I said, I think I said it, this attack was discovered in 1998,
mm-hmm.
so it's been around for almost 20 years,
mm-hmm.
and it's still today just responsible for leaking massive user information in applications on a daily basis, more or less. And the problem is that we are not writing SQL statements in the correct way.
Mm-hmm.
And we will have a look on at the problem soon. So we could say that, oh, what a good thing we are not using SQL in this course because we are using a document database instead. But
we should think about injections as a bigger stuff. You will have, when talking about NoSQL databases, you have a lot of difference, and some of them have some query languages where you are using in Mongo's, for example. You can use some JavaScript code to do these questions, and okay, so you inject stuff and make that code running if you don't be aware. Yep. So you have injections vectors in NoSQL databases or whatever.
So always be aware, not just if you're using a NoSQL Server database or SQL database, but if you are using a SQL database, you should definitely look out for SQL injections because it's so common.
And that's why we're going to talk, even if we're not using relational databases.
Yeah. So maybe if you are reading a database course in parallel to this one, you might touch upon it in that course, but we will still just show the problem. So even though we haven't talked about SQL, it's quite obvious what this line of code of the top one is doing. It's select everything from the table users, where username is the username provided, and in this case we're taking the request, we are reading the username right off the request and inserting it with a concatenation.
So we have it will be the same thing that the user writes in the text input.
Yeah, and we trust the user will write his or her username. However, the user will not.
The username will be that.
No. This is quite a strange username. So it has a lot of things that shouldn't be in the username. For instance, blank spaces.
Yeah.
But injecting this code will result in this string. So select star from user where username equals an empty string, or 1 = 1.
That's true.
Yeah, that's true. So that is true. So the where statement is true. So this will select everything from the table user.
Yeah.
Not only the user we are looking for, everything.
Yeah.
And depending on how you present this information, you might dump all of your user database right out to the attacker with just writing this line of code in a login form. So
we injected, we know how the SQL query language is working, so we could inject something that will run as code or a SQL question.
Yeah.
So that's what injection is all about.
Yeah.
Then this case is obviously pretty stupid because you never select star from user
never.
No, but you should be aware of that. Okay, I maybe just need this and this. And
yeah, and you should always, filter so you only get one post, for instance.
Yeah.
Yeah, things like that.
And you maybe won't render out this information in a way. So. That's the main how it works. Yeah.
Beware. So this is I love this picture. It's on a parking lot somewhere. It's quite old, but so we are talking about injecting code into a user field. As I said, you will probably protect your user input fields because they are like obvious for attacks. But you never know how you will get the data. So this is of course not a it's just a joke, this picture, but in some way it's serious, because so this car has this, instead of the license plate, it has this this line of code on the front, so the thing being driving through speed cameras or payment cameras, it will take a photo of the car. It will interpretate the sign on the car, and it will take this and insert it into a database.
Question.
This question, so it will kind of do a question and drop database table, whatever.
And we don't have to pay.
so we will get away with it.
Yeah.
And I mean, yeah, of course this is a joke, but it shows that, I mean, you never know where the input is coming from. And another classical example is in the elections, in the government elections, at least in Sweden, you can vote for whatever party you like. You can write, like, I want to vote for Donald Duck party. That's a classic. But you could also write, I mean, you could write whatever. And the people interpreting the text and putting it into the database will, or people, the systems doing this and reading will read the text. So you often see, if you look at the votes submitted, you will find things like trying to do drop table votes.
Kind of SQL injection.
Yeah, so it's quite fun to look at.
Yeah, you can Google it up and see different kind of part being voted for.
So this will take some time, but for a real example that actually happened.
Okay.
I think, I don't remember where I heard this, so I cannot quote where I got it from. I think it was the security podcast, the Swedish security podcast. It's a really good podcast that I could highly recommend. It's in Swedish though, but so I think it was Amazon. I mean, they sold a lot of books in the beginning. Now they sell everything, but they had they were really famous for their bookstore. So a security expert wrote a book about injection attacks.
Okay.
So, and in this book, there was an example of how to do an injection attack on a page, like showing an alert and stuff. And Amazon made a preview of this book on the preview page. This preview page had a vulnerability that this book took advantage of. Mm-hmm. So when users visited the book page and opened the preview, this code started running in the browser. and I mean, getting code from a textbook being scanned in and presented in a book, that's pretty
advanced.
but I mean, it shows that it's so hard to know where your input is getting, and I guess in Slack you get
the classical XKCD. So how to protect against SQL injections? Well, we're not going to talk about that, but in PHP or .NET or whatever, you have ways to adding this user input into the SQL query in a way
using
that
parameters
that will
store procedures.
Will sanitize this kind of way. So it's depending on the platform.
You should never do this. You should never concatenate.
You have to check the user input. As we say, always be suspicious.
Yeah. And as you've written, there are many databases, so we can't go through them all. Just be aware that different databases could have different attack possibilities.
Yeah.
And you need to read up on the database you are using. And we are using Mongo, for instance. Mm. As you said, using Mongo's, you could ask questions.
Oh, maybe I said wrong. That's maybe the MongoDB native driver I was talking about, so I may be confused. So I think Mongoose is handling all inputs as strings. But you should be aware of the problem anyway, of course.
Yep.
So check your database query language and always be suspicious about user inputs. Yep. That's the main.
We do not want any students going out writing applications that are vulnerable for SQL injection attacks. Please don't. We have been there in the past, I think, actually.
Oh, yeah. You're going to tell me about that later.
Yeah, I think it was back in a big newspaper.
Aha. Uh-huh.
That was, Let's leave it at that. So, we're leaving those attack vectors and start looking at going up. why am I down there?
I don't know what you did.
And start looking at how to implement user management and authorization or authentication in our applications.
So we're going to be more practical going down to the application and express framework.
And, I mean, when you write applications as a developer, you have a responsibility. You are kind of you are taking data from users, and users will trust that you handle this data in a good way, in a secure way, and you should not take lightly upon that responsibility. And the first thing I think that you should ask yourself is, am I really the one who should be responsible for storing passwords?
Yeah.
Can I do it in another way? Can I, for instance, use Facebook for
authentication? You've probably seen that some sites you could do a login through Facebook or Twitter or GitHub or whatever. And then they are taking responsibility of this login procedure. So.
And using OpenID or
There are different kind of techniques for doing that. We have the OAuth, three-legged
for authorization and authentication as well.
And meaning that you can implement in your website a way for the user to connect to this OAuth provider, what it may be, Facebook or Twitter or whatever, do the login through them, and they give the user a token that we could be using. And we have to register this procedure at Facebook or Twitter or stuff. Yeah, we're not going to talk about OAuth in this course, but it's an interesting thing to look up, and you could implement it in the last assignment if you want.
Yeah.
Do some extra work. So do a search for OAuth or OpenID, and you will find solutions from that. And often you will find libraries written to make this pretty easy to implement.
But in many cases, you will not be able to just cope with using Facebook or Twitter because your users might not be on those networks.
No, of course. You will want to write your own login system, and we're gonna, in this course, we're gonna talk about
how writing our own system for this, because that's the thing that you need to have done. I mean, as a web developer. So first of all, one point that I think is really important is to inform the user how you're handling the user's credentials. Many sites are really, really bad at this.
Yeah, you may think that isn't that a security information, that if we tell others how we do it,
we are at risk.
It will be much more easy to hack us.
Yeah, but I mean, if you have a problem telling the users how you store their credentials or how you're handling their credentials, you're probably doing it in the wrong way.
Yeah, exactly.
So if you're doing it in a right way and you have method of doing it, you should be able to present that method as well. I think so, at least. I mean, you don't need to go into detail specifics that, so we are hashing your password 3,695 times. You could say that your password is hashed multiple times and salted and whatever.
Yeah, we will get into those
terms. But I mean, you could tell the user that, I mean, for me as a user visiting your site, I will trust you even more because you are open with how you do this stuff, and that's a good thing, I think. One topic that is always up for discussion is how to force the user to handle the user's password, or force the user how to create their passwords. What's your take on this?
Well, In some cases, you should always allow, as we say, always allow special characters and long password. We have visited and using sites that just allows, it must be 6 digits. Yeah. But what?
The biggest grocery store in Sweden has that.
To hang them up.
Horrible.
Yeah. And that's weird, so you should always allow that. Then you can set that the user minimum of 6 or 8 characters, and it must be special characters and 1 digits. That could...
I hate that.
Yeah, it's very annoying. You should be able to show you, as a user, you also have responsibility for your own passwords, of course. So you shouldn't be too forced how to create them, I think.
Yeah.
But there could be a discussion. Okay, we will say that it should be at least a couple of characters long or something. That's a common use.
So as we get in the chat, that HBO Nordic also allows 6 digits as password, and I think that's okay. Mm-hmm. I mean, If you are using 6 digits passwords on HBO Nordic, I think the problem is at your end. Because, I mean, you should not do that. But because you should know better. But in the case that I refer to, you can only have 6 digits. Nothing more, nothing less. Which is a big problem. Mm. But I mean, you could discuss this in many ways. But my take on this is, as you said, have a minimum length of maybe 6 characters, but don't force the user to have 2 digits, for instance, because when I have a 100 characters long password, I will probably have more than 2 digits, and I will not be allowed. So I will be hassle for me to get a password that fits your criteria. A better model, I think, is that it's commonly used, is this password strength mechanism for you, so that you get a bar saying
widget stuff that it's if you have a weak password it will be red, and if you have a strong it will be green.
So you try to infer, or you try to
make the user think about it.
That's a better way. But we will talk about the personal aspect of passwords tomorrow. We will not go into that here. So allow special characters, especially allow long passwords. Don't have like a client validation telling the user that the password can only be 30 characters, because that, I mean, at least give them 1,000 characters or something like that. That in practice it will not matter, because you will not save that password in the end. So you don't care about how long it is. Up to the user. Remember your responsibility. Yeah, we talked about this.
If you store users information, you must know your responsibilities
so
keep it secure.
Yeah, so let's just show an example how we can do this, saving it using Mongoose in a schema.
Yeah, and we talked about schemas last time, and you will probably end up with a user model or something like that. And in this case, we're doing a schema with, you could have a username, but in many cases you're using the email, because it's a unique thing connecting to the user, and you will use it doing recovering of passwords and stuff like that. And you can set on the schema that it should be required, it should be unique, so you get a validation directly into Mongoose about that. So that's nothing new. You could, we're talking about validating more manually stuff, and you can use this dot path, checking just a password, what do you call it, property, before saving it, doing some validation. You use the validate function that takes an callback, and there you check it. In this case, we check it that it's 6 characters, or the length of the password is 6 or over.
Yeah.
So it will return true or false in that case. And we also could give a message that we could use when rendering the error view.
But after, I mean, this is not the only step you will take, so we'll get into more steps, because you should not just, okay, so it's more than six characters, then we save it. No, we have more things to do when we should do hashing, for instance.
But that and just how to implement, if you want more validation,
the validation part you will
figure it out.
Yeah, and of course, I mean, this is a pattern you can use for validating other stuff as well, the email errors, for instance.
If check up the path stuff there.
Yeah. Okay, moving on to password.
Yeah, I think it's more, we have said the first point there, we have talked about it,
Yeah. So, the second one is that's an important one.
And that can make you wonder, what?
You should never, ever, in your application or in another way, like reading from the database, be able to read the user's password back. Never, ever. That should not be possible.
Okay.
And you can wonder, well that's strange.
That's gonna be hard.
How can we do a login? And the thing is, in this case, is that we are doing hash of the password. And as you probably know, a hash is a one-way cryptation. Is it called? Or a one-way hashing of the string. So that this password will be transformed using a hashing algorithm into a string.
But you can't take that string and get it, the reversed password back. No. Because that's mathematical magic, I guess.
So when you get a letter in your mailbox, your physical mailbox from your favorite company saying, oh, it was a long time since you visited us, maybe you have forgotten your credentials. Your username is this and this is your password. Then you should be really angry and contact this company and say, what the hell are you doing? And that has happened a lot of times as well. I mean, we have a lot of quite big companies over the years that have stored the credential and still do.
We still get that kind of emails.
Yeah. So the thing is to be able to hash this password. And we hash the password using a secure algorithm.
Yeah, that cannot be reversed. As you see, we have put MD5, SHA-1, SHA-256 as avoid. And they were secure till you broke it, or we're getting more and more computer
power.
So you can
brute force.
Yeah, exactly. So we're gonna suggest Argon 2. I think I read a test that's the best of these. I don't know. I haven't used it myself. I think we will use in our examples the bcrypt algorithm. And there are the scripts I haven't used that.
Yeah, so bcrypt is an implementation of the Bluefish.
Don't use the MD5.
No. So use some of those or read up what is the latest or best hashing algorithm.
Yeah, and these things could change because you can find a
flawed
problems with one of them and
Okay, so we are hashing the password and we are saving it in the database. We are not saving the password per se, we are saving the hashed version. This is just a string with random characters. Will that be enough?
Yeah, you may think about this MD5 stuff and you probably heard that someone has taken the database and it's done in MD5 hashing and we think it was good, but they can still hack and get the password back. So we're gonna talk about how to do that.
Yeah. So one really common attack is using something called rainbow tables or a dictionary attack. And if you look at stolen credentials, I mean there are databases where you can get I get 8 million passwords from a database with stolen real passwords and their usernames. You could have a look at those and you will quickly identify that the most common password is 12345.
No, okay.
Six, meh. Maybe. Yeah. And QWERTY and all of those, login and password key combinations and stuff. Yeah. So many people are using the same passwords as other people, and a good way of getting this the hash is just doing hashes for those common passwords.
So they will always be the same.
Yeah. So if you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and you hash it with bcrypt two times, you will always get the same result. And that's how we could authenticate the user again. So what you do is you get those rainbow tables that is hashing of the most popular words or passwords, and then you just compare. You just compare the hash of the stolen database, maybe by a SQL injection, and you compare it with your rainbow table, and you will see that, oh, those are the passwords without needing to break the algorithm.
Okay, that's this user is using this password, and now I can log into the system.
And how do we stop that from happening? Because that's
we must have some way to make it. We could do the hashing more times.
Yeah, we could. I mean, we could do the hashing 25 times.
Yeah, and it's gotta be
times.
Every password will have
different hashes.
Yeah, so that's gonna be a lot harder.
Yeah, because then you need to make a rainbow table that hashes as many times as well. So you need to do a specific rainbow table against your application. But still, I mean, if you know that the hashing is done 10 times, you could easily do a rainbow table and you could crack a lot of passwords.
We must have some other techniques.
So this is introducing salts. The problem is that people tend to use the same password as other people. Are you using same password as other people?
I try to avoid it. I did in the past, but I think I have got that
bad habit away. Yeah, you're using some kind of random password for each and every site, and we will discuss that tomorrow.
Yeah, I think I won't say too much about that.
So if everybody did that, you didn't need to have a salt. But because many people are using the same password, we need to add something to the password, and that's called a salt. So let's have a look at this flow. So first of all, we are trying to create an account on a site. So the user tries to register a password, and the password is this one. Might not be used by a lot, but it could be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So what we do, this is not enough. We cannot trust the user's password. We need to add something more before we hash it. And then we add a salt, the salt.
And that's just extra string.
An extra string that is just randomized. It could be the same string for the whole application. But if you do that, you could generate a rainbow table matching that string when you do. So you should probably avoid it. You should generate a random string for every user. So this is the generated string. What is it? 7 characters. You can do whatever you like.
I think you
might have it longer.
Of the slide.
And then you concatenate the user password with the salt. You get this new string, and this string will probably be unique. You will not find two users with the same string. Then you hash that string, and you save that and the salt to the database. So, if you do this by hand, maybe you save the hash in one column of database, and you save the salt in another column. It's not a problem that the salt is in clear text, because it prevents rainbow tabling, and that's the purpose of the salt.
So it's maybe, we put it wrong, generates a secret random string, the salt.
Yeah.
It must not be secret.
No, it could be public. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't matter. This is not a secret. It's just to make the hash not look like everybody else's hash with the same password. In application, you can find all sort of things. I mean, you can do this. You don't need to store it in the database. You could actually store it in your code. You can just have it as a string in your code, adding it. And there are those who are saying that you should do both, because if you get a hold of the database, you will not get a hold of the code maybe, so you will not get that salt, and the opposite way around. But I think that's, I mean, you're preventing rainbow attacks either way, and that is the most important thing, I think.
Okay.
But I mean, you could do this in different ways. However, so this is if you do it manually. If you're using some kind of library for this, you will probably see that the salt will be added to the hashed password in the database, and so you will save it in the same field, and there is no need for having multiple columns or multiple properties in the database. Probably the module we will use.
Yeah, the bcrypt model will. We don't have to think about that so much.
Yeah, as it says, but below bcrypt has all built into generated hashes. So that module will take care of the problem for you.
But as always, okay, it will simplify stuff, but you should know about this anyway, so you don't just do the stuff and not thinking about it.
I need to check the battery status. Could you just talk about this slide?
Yeah. Well, this slide is about how we do. It's more way telling how to do the user register a user on your site. The things we should do. Well, the first thing, the client will fills in the form. Okay, of course we have some client validation. Telling more, as we said, telling the user that okay, you should do this and this more, giving input to the user how to fill in the forms, things that are required, the email, passwords, and stuff like that. The next thing, check the username or the email will always be unique, so we have to check that it doesn't exist in our application. We have to do a query to the database, so we don't have two users with the same username or email. We have to do the hash of the password
with the salt.
Yeah, exactly. Before saving the user to the database, so we have to hook up before saving the user, and we're gonna look at how to do it in Mongoose. And when we have done that, we could save the hashed password string into the database, and we have registered the user with the, along with the other user information, of course.
Yeah. So important in this case is that okay. So we are saving the hashed password in the database, and the reason why it's hashed and not in clear text is if we get compromised. So if someone is getting hold of our database, I mean, it could be through an attack on the web application, it could be a server administrator stealing the database, it could be an employee on the support department looking in the database, whatever.
Getting fire and then going into the database and taking stuff. Yeah.
So I mean, we are preventing damage if we get compromised.
Yeah.
So that's the important thing with hashing and the salt. So in practice, if our web application never get compromised, I mean, it's not a problem storing the password in the database. But we must take the stand that our database will get compromised. And if it will get compromised, it should be hashed using a strong algorithm with a salt. So that's basically it.
Yeah. Should we look at, or should we have some
questions? Could you?
I
will talk about all the .se or have I been pawned.com tomorrow. So I will not touch upon user passwords today.
So should we look at some code for doing this? And as we said, we get a lot of help with the. In this case, we're using the bcrypt module or library.
Yeah.
So this is, we shouldn't maybe talk much about this.
No, not so much. But it's good to see one implementation of.
And observe, we are using. Okay, we're using the user schema as we used before, and we're using the pre. Hook.
Yeah.
So this code is used before saving is done. So think of it like a middleware before saving it into data. And that's a perfect...
And you see you had the next...
exactly.
Introducing middlewares.
And observe this is asynchronous.
Yeah.
So it's non-blocking code. And that's very important because we want this thing to take some time. Yeah.
Yeah.
We have a, in the gensalt, we have a, the a first 10. Parameter, the 10.
Yeah.
That's, I think it's rounds, does it?
I'm not sure it's just how many rounds the crypt will, the hashing will be done. I think it's just general, I don't remember, it was a year since I read up on it. But it's actually telling you how difficult it, how difficult this hash will be.
I think the default value is 10, but you can set it higher or lower.
And of course, if you set this really high, you will use a lot of CPU on your server machine. So this is easy to kind of weigh this against performance versus security. If you have, I mean, it's good if this takes like a second or half a second or at least 200 milliseconds or something like that. So that it the hash is not too fast, because if it's too fast, you could have a lot of brute forcing being done against your database.
Yeah, exactly. And that's why you want this to take some time.
Yeah.
And also know that in these libraries, there will be synchronous functions. Don't use it.
No.
So because you're going to block the
thread. The main queue and blocking it for quite a substantial amount of time.
Yeah.
If you do the asynchronous way, this will be handled in another
thread on the server. C++ libraries.
Yeah. I don't think it's, I mean, it's a regular callback pattern. You will get salt.
Yeah, you could of course use arrow functions and stuff like that. Maybe you get some problem with the context, I don't know. But
So
that's up to you to find.
So this was actually generating the salt. I was wrong. So it wasn't the hashing. The hashing is done downstairs. Down here. So this one will get us a salt.
Yeah.
A randomized salt, and then we use that salt together with a password to hash our password using bcrypt in this case, or RMU or whatever.
Mm.
But as this hashing method has a place for the salt, so it will use the salt that we provide, and it will store the salt together with the hash.
So we don't have to think
about it
so much.
No.
And then the null stuff, I think it's a progress callback.
If it takes a long time, you could.
And then you have a callback for when done.
Mm.
So you have the arrow first pattern. And that's why we do that, and then we get the hash that we add to the user property password and next, and then it will be saved down to the database, but with the updated hash as a password.
Mm. Yeah, so pretty straightforward, I think.
Yeah.
Okay, moving on to, we have a couple of minutes. Talk about user management, authentication and authorization.
And that was registering the user
when
creating the user account. Yeah.
And now we need to authenticate the user. We need to authorize the user.
The user should be able to log into our application in our
authentication.
Yeah, and authorization is we should check that the logged in user get the correct resources, so we can't look. I can't look at or delete your blog post or stuff like that, and that's authorized.
Yeah,
and that's pretty funny. You have.
I need to look at the next slide so I know it's.
Yeah, because you have in the HTTP protocol, you have status codes.
Yep.
Status codes, and if you do a great login, okay, it's okay, and a redirect. We are talking about this
the
pattern.
Correct login will regenerate a 200 or a 300 redirect.
But if you fail to log in, you get a 401.
That is
unauthorized. That's pretty stupid, because authorized is the getting the resource, and you can discuss that. That's pretty, it should have another name or something that, but what it's telling you, yeah, exactly, and what it's telling you, okay, you are not logging, you failed to log in, please try again, probably. The authorization stuff, if when you try to get a result, you enter the URL or trying to do something you're not supposed to do, you get a 403 forbidden. Mm. You should send out a 403 telling more in a strict manner. Just don't try this again. No. You have to log in. Go to the login stuff. You probably redirect to the login view or something. But that's what this HTTP status are telling us.
Yeah. So now we have the user created and stored in the database, and it has its hashed password. The problem is now, we don't have the user password. How can we authenticate the user without having the user's password? And so the flow for this is that the user is writing its username and password, and we are getting this username and password, and then we hash the password together with a salt, and then we compare the hashes, and if those compare, we know that the user is without knowing the real password.
Yeah.
And this is kind of the flow once again for doing this. And setting cookies as well. So when the user is authenticated, we generate a session, probably with a secure session cookie. Mm. And this last step is, don't forget to give the user the possibility to log off. As we said with the CSERF attack, I mean, it's important that the user can.
You should have a log off button and destroy the session when the user has and redirecting back to the start page or whatever.
And if you're doing a really secure application like a bank application, of course, you should have some kind of timeout probably that that destroys the session after, say, 15 minutes.
Yeah, you should probably.
I think you would be some, quite irritated if GitHub would log you out every 15 minutes.
Yeah, but you can see in some cases you have the ability to set stay login. Yeah, I think they have some timeout on it. But
you know the drill.
Yeah, I don't think we have to talk about this. And we have some code doing this. Okay, the only thing, you use the user schema as always, and you can add methods. So you add a method to the schema, like a method to the model.
Yeah.
And in this case, we call it compare passwords. Mm. And you using
BigQuery's compare method.
Yeah.
And it will handle the salt for us.
So and you have the candidate password, the password the user trying to log in with. Mm. And we look up in the database
the hash
and compare them.
Mm. So I guess this password is the hash, and this is the user password. Okay.
Yeah.
So this is an important part, of course, how to handle your own passwords. And there is a discussion going on in Slack right now on this topic. But that's a little bit too much for this lesson. So I will talk more about that, and we can have a discussion in Växjö.
Yeah, tomorrow. it's a great thing to have peer instruction about you can have a lot of discussion about how to
store your passwords, how to handle your passwords
as a user.
Yeah, as a user. So we will skip that right now. This is all authorization of resources and
it's you have to in your roots you check the things that have to have some security check about that, and you can create root router all or stuff like that to a regular expression to check the different URL mappings, of course, and where you in this case check the session. Okay, is this the correct user and stuff like that, and using it as a middleware.
Yeah.
So we don't go into the code more than this.
HTTPS is something that we will leave until tomorrow because we will not be able to put that in so minus we have, 4 minutes.
We will have a little short lecture about these things also
tomorrow. So please be there on the peer instruction in 1167.
We will not record it.
I think. And we will skip that. So this is the second to last lecture, as I said, next week.
If you look at the prospect, have two more.
Yeah.
We will have one lecture like this, and we will talk about real-time web applications. Mm-hmm. And we will talk about server push, long polling, web sockets, web hooks, stuff like that, which will be the last assignment. Handling this kind of thing. Then we have a lecture kind of things, not we sitting here, but you will have a lot of resources, a lot of
recording
demos to watch, handling the production stuff, how to get our stuff up to whatever server we want to use, how to secure it, how to run it in production. So that will be the last.
Yeah,
stuff.
Last step in the course.
Yeah,
and it's the Christmas is closing in as well, and you will.
We will be ready with this stuff before Christmas.
So no Christmas, you are supposed to work with the third assignment.
Yeah,
and I think that is pretty much that. Right?
Yeah, for today. Yeah, so we will be in Växjö tomorrow at
10:15 in 11:67. Don't miss out on that. Be there. We will, if the train doesn't stop on the way. You never know.
As we always.
Yeah. So if we're not there, please have a look in the Slack, and we will try to post a message if we're stuck in Emmaboda, which is usually the case. So okay.
Yeah.
See you tomorrow.
Bye.